paper on Anne Boleyn at a conference on French historical studies, you ask. In this essay, I suggest a revision of Anne Boleyn's image, which requires us to consider why or what this young English woman could have learned at the French court. The notion of Anne as a bombshell, I believe, fundamentally mischaracterizes her. To grasp the magnitude of the distortion, we need only imagine any one of the pious women associated both with the Reform and the French court: Queen Claude, Michelle de Sorbonne, Renée of Ferrara, Marguerite of Navarre, Louise de Montmorency, Jacqueline de Longwy, Madeleine de Mailly, Jeanne d'Albret, or Catherine de Bourbon, being routinely described, like Anne Boleyn, as, I quote, a sexy woman with an exotic allure, as a woman who, another quote, was well aware of her sexual powers and made the most of them, or as a woman with an air of sexuality and seduction about her that made men lose their heads, literally in some cases. Another quote, as a woman of all conquering confidence and charm who is simply irresistible. Another quote, who was well aware of her sexuality, having spent her formative years at the libidinous French court and had mastered the art of seduction, or who, in the words of her most famous biographer, Eric Ives, radiated sex. I begin by examining the concept of the bombshell. The version of sexiness attributed to Anne — she was never described as a great beauty, quoting again, but even those who loathed her admitted that she had a dramatic allure, another quotation. Scarcely a contemporary did not allude to her chemistry that encompassed her. All of that has a history developing around the mid-19th century. Anne's contemporaries just didn't think in those terms. So in the second part of this essay, I reimagine the queen based on contemporary descriptions, which will lead us to the French court. Although I cannot develop the point today in any detail, I conclude with a few sentences on what, if not her sex appeal, made her so attractive to Henry VIII. The popular image of Anne Boleyn reflects the modern construction of sexiness as distinct from beauty. Contemporary sources reveal why the trope is so easily applied to Anne Boleyn. Eyewitness reports that she was not beautiful, plus Henry VIII's obvious desire to marry her. First, we have the lukewarm reports of eyewitnesses. One example describes her as, I quote, young, good-looking, of rather dark complexion, and likely enough to have children. That was the Florentine ambassador, and then the Florentine ambassador, Carlo Capello, whose words are recorded in the diary of the Venetian historian Marino Sanuto, notes that she is, I quote again, not the handsomest woman in the world. She is of middling stature, swarthy complexion, long neck, wide mouth, bosom not much raised, and in fact has nothing but the English king's great appetite and her eyes, which are black and beautiful. I will return to this quotation of Carlo Capello. With eyewitness reports, we have the testimony of the Catholic priest Nicholas Sanders, who never actually saw Anne Boleyn, but discredited her by giving her the signs of a witch. Anne Boleyn was rather tall of stature, with black hair and an oval face of sallow complexion, as if troubled with jaundice. She had a projecting tooth under the upper lip, and on her right hand, six fingers. There was even a large wen under her chin. George Wyatt, who is the grandson of Thomas Wyatt, the poet, normalizes the allegorizing propaganda by dovetailing it with the eyewitness attempts at objective description, and he comes up with this. There was found indeed upon the side of her nail, upon one of her fingers, some little show of a nail, which was yet so small, by the report of those that have seen her, as the workmaster seemed to leave it an occasion of greater grace to her hand, which, with the tip of one of her fingers, might be, and was usually, by her hidden hand, by her hidden, without any least blemish to it. Likewise, there were said to be upon some parts of her body certain small spots incident to the clearest complexions. So here she is, the not very pretty Anne Boleyn, and now she only needs seductive powers to become the bombshell we know so well. For these, we'll turn to Henry VIII's passion, but we'll wait for the conclusion for that. And for now, let's consider the other principal source for her presumed sex appeal, that is Lancelot du Cal's narrative poem about her downfall. Residing in London and possibly witnessing her execution, Carl took her guilt for granted. His great contribution to the image of the sexy Anne Boleyn is his description of her eyes. And here they are. In addition to the exquisite talents and graces that she happily acquired in France, she was beautiful and elegant of figure, and still more because of her eyes, still more attractive because of her eyes, which she knew how to use to advantage. So let's keep Carl's eyes on hold, and we're going to go back for a moment to Capello's description that we just looked at. So following the passage that I cited above, here it is, that's the one that we just looked at, that she was not the handsomest woman in the world. Following that passage is translated in the State Papers of Venice, we read, "And her eyes take great effect on those who serve the queen." That's the translation of the passage in Italian that you see right there. And yet that translation, "and yet her eyes take great effect on those who serve the queen," that translation is grammatically impossible. The "a," the third person singular present of avere, to have, cannot go with Anne's eyes, which are plural. It can only go with Anne herself. And then if you look at the Italian, it says something like, Anne herself has whatever this mysterious interminamento or interminamento, whatever that word is. No one quite knows what that means. She has those in greater number or fashion than the queen, presumably Catherine of Aragon, would have had, the subjunctive. So whatever that passage means, and no one really knows, whatever it means, it says nothing about Anne's eyes, which are plural. But when later readers interpreted that sentence in light of the passage by Carl that we've just looked at, it seemed to reinforce Carl's comment. But Capello's flirtatious eyes are a figment of the modern imagination, and as for Carl, what he's doing is trying to make sense of an otherwise inexplicable crime by highlighting early signs of Anne's later depravity, precisely because she seems so exemplary to her contemporaries. Even the king's apologist, William Thomas, cannot reconcile Anne's outward profession of gravity with her presumed crimes, and he concludes that inwardly she was all another dame than she seemed to be. So on the surface, she appeared to be a very grave and pious woman. Contemporaries, convinced of her infidelity, cast Anne's ability to arouse lust in entirely negative terms. One source asserts that she followed daily her frail and carnal lust and did falsely and treacherously procure by base conversations, kisses and touchings, gifts and other infamous incitations, diverse of the king's daily and familiar servants to be her adulterers. Other contemporary references to Anne's alleged seductive powers are equally negative, refined versions of the obscene epithets that disgruntled subjects of the king aimed at her. Think here, for example, of the infamous goggle-eyed whore epithet. In other words, they are entirely predictable insults. Sexual desire in the 16th century had none of the mystery that we attributed it today, that surplus attraction in Lacan's sense of surplus. In their very materialist culture, our early modern counterparts categorize sexual desire as an inevitable urge, like hunger, meant to be appeased but not overindulged. Moreover, different from our own period, where the stereotype holds that women seek out high prestige men and then withhold sex until they're sure that they will be provided for, and this is the model typically applied to Henry and Anne's love letters, that characterizes women, whereas men, in contrast, are evolutionarily programmed to spread their seed and they will have sex with anyone who will have them. Until the 19th century, from the 19th century on, before that, women were perceived as more sexually aggressive than men, much more the victim of their desires, and because the need to bear a child was often so great, they were assumed to be willing to have sex with anyone who would have them. Finally, sexual relations had what seemed to us to be an oddly public aspect. Marguerite of Navarre, the sister of the French king, François Ier, Marguerite of Navarre, for example, comments to the Duke of Norfolk, who is Anne's uncle, about François Ier, her brother, the King of France, and François's second queen, that these 7 months, he neither lay with her nor yet meddled with her. And Norfolk asks why, surprised? To which Marguerite replies that the king did not find her, that is his second queen, did not find her pleasing to his appetite, adding that she is very hot in bed and desireth too much to be embraced. And Marguerite then laughs and remarks, "I would not for all the good in Paris that my husband, the King of Navarre, were no better pleased to be in my bed than my brother is to be in the queen's," end of quote. And yet no historian remarks on Marguerite's sexual allure. We might also mention that François Premier and his queen, his first queen, Claude, about those two, that the king held the queen in such honor and respect that when he was in France and was with her, he never failed to sleep with her each night. And yet Claude, of course, is never imagined as sexually alluring, on the contrary. We can date the appeal attributed to Anne by modern historians to the mid-19th century. This type of appeal represents a version of desire that literary theoretician René Girard proposes as the basis of romantic love as depicted by writers such as Stendhal, Flaubert, and Proust. Girard, of course, understands all desire as fundamentally mimetic or triangular, in that we never desire an object for its inherent value, but because others desire it. The desire for a particular type of woman that Girard labels the coquette is also mimetic, but mediated not through a rival, rather through the coquette's narcissistic desire, in other words, her desire for herself. The desire that she arouses then depends not on her beauty, but on her self-love, her own self-involvement. Women who arouse desire are self-sufficient and hard to get. As of the mid to late 19th century, European literature starts to abound with this type of woman. And I'll offer just one example of the very many types that we can find. Proust's Swan observes that Odette's qualities were not such as to justify his setting so high a value on the hours he spent in her company. The sexy Anne first appears predictably in the 1860s. Historian John S. Brewer gives her a David Copperfield's Dora-type sexuality. She was a little, lively, sparkling brunette with fascinating eyes and long black hair, which, contrary to the somber fashion of those days, she wore coquettishly floating loosely down her back. Other accounts give her sexuality a darker cast. Historian James Froude opines that Anne's eyes are large, but the expression is not pleasing and indicates cunning more than thought, passion more than feeling, while the heavy lips and massive chin wear a look of sensuality, which is not to be mistaken. And historian A.P. Pollard inserts that she appealed to the less refined part of Henry's nature. She was preeminent neither in beauty nor intellect. In the rest of this essay, I'll focus on the grace that seems to have been Anne's most salient characteristic, judging by contemporary comments. In 1514, Anne joined the French royal court as a lady-in-waiting for Mary Tudor, the bride of Louis XII. Although Louis died just months later, Anne remained at the French court at the request of the new King Claude, returning to England only in 1521. Numerous English contemporaries mention the grace that she had acquired in France, and I'll give you some quotations. In proportion of body, might compare with the rest of the ladies and gentlewomen of the court, albeit in beauty she was to many inferior, but for her manners, grace, attire, and tongue, she excelled them all, for she had been brought up in France with Madame, and then there's a blank in the manuscript, a very noble lady. Another quotation. Specifically, she was eloquent and graceful. Another quotation. She had many outward good qualities in playing instruments, singing, and other such courtly graces. Her graces included singing well, dancing, constructing wise statements, and playing the lute and other instruments. And here I'm quoting Lancelot de Cal. Her beauty and graces of nature, this is George Wyatt, her beauty and graces of nature were graced by gracious education, and she was one of witty and graceful speech. So what is grace exactly? Well, clearly it includes musical talent, but what else? What it most certainly was not was erotic appeal. The lifestyles of the French women with whom Anne was associated at court were impeccable, and they were all extolled for their grace as well. Descriptions of Queen Claude mirror this ideal. Queen Claude was, quote, very cultivated, generous, pious, the summit of feminine grace. Claude's sister, Renée of Ferrara, reportedly possessed similar qualities. Clément Marot, the poet, who had passed time in exile at her court in Ferrara, remembered her grace, her grâce divine, her divine graces. Marguerite of Navarre, with her quick mind and knowledge that astonishes and above all such grace, this is Marot again, whether she's speaking or silent, so Marguerite also possesses grace. And Marguerite was the ideal courtier, Marot goes on to say. Pious and eloquent, possessing the gift of persuasion, and I think this is what grace really is. Pious and eloquent, possessing the gift of persuasion, she dealt very well with ambassadors, pleasing them with beautiful discourses for which she had a magnificent talent. Baldassare Castiglione's book, The Courtier, which was published in 1528 and translated into French in 1538, but it was floating around in manuscript long before that, from the first years of François Premier's reign, provides a useful guide to further amplify what grace might be. Graceful courtiers, for Castiglione, exhibit a weight of character, una tanto grave autorità, and simultaneously a light manner of conversation. Although, as he explains, grace typically inheres in the nobility, others could acquire it through imitation, but they had to give the impression of possessing it naturally. And by that he means by they had to practice in everything a certain nonchalance, or the famous spezzatura. Carl depicts Anne acquiring her grace through imitation, listening wisely to the ladies-in-waiting who sought to incite all minds and to incite all minds to imitate them well, à bien les imiter. And Anne Boleyn obviously succeeded because everyone took her for French. So Anne returned to England, exuding courtly grace, not sex. But she brought another tendency as well. In addition to their grace, Claude, René, and Marguerite were at the center of the early French reform. It's been argued that because Anne left France before the real flourishing of evangelism at the French court, which didn't come until later in the mid-1520s, she had not been influenced by these ideas. However, recent research on Queen Claude shows her intervening in certain Benedictine houses already in 1516 and addressing the king on behalf of various reformers, including Berquin, Lefebvre, Arnaud de Brunos, and Erasmus. Anne's books verify that she absorbed the ideas of the reform during her years at the French court. Other evidence of Anne's interest is her protection of the young evangelical master of arts, Nicolas Bourbon, whom Marguerite and Navarre sent to her for protection. In addition, the sheer number of references to Anne's activity on behalf of the reform are unambiguous. To cite Nancy Rolker's definition of the feminist humanist reformer, Anne too, although she doesn't cite Anne, but I'm saying Anne too should be seen as an example of a new phenomenon that arose when a woman whose cultivation of piety, which was an important virtue in the traditional and theoretical conceptions of women, combined with the new humanist learning. To conclude, what made Anne so attractive to Henry VIII? For many historians, citing Eric Ives here again, the reply is that establishing a reliable image for Anne Boleyn only accentuates the evidence of contemporaries that her attraction was not outstanding beauty. What then, continues Ives, explains her power? And this is Ives again. In the first place, she radiated sex. Of course, Henry VIII was accused of being motivated by lust, which he denied, as we would expect. But is it really reasonable to assume that the king moved heaven and earth to marry a woman to whom he was physically attracted? To assume that women inspire great love only through beauty or sexual desirability, is that really so reasonable? Does anyone imagine Elizabeth Barrett Browning as holding Robert Browning in thrall through the power of sex? Or did Harriet Taylor, Effie Gray, Abigail Adams, Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin, Julia Grant, Alice B. Toklas, choose your lover, did they radiate sex? No, they provided intelligent, supportive companionship. And surely Anne did this too. But we can be more precise. The king believed, I think, that Anne had been providentially selected to bear the Tudor male heir, and their commitment, their mutual commitment to this divine calling, gave their relationship its urgency. They quickly received proof of God's approval. The king announces in 1533 that it doth evidently appear by many things, that is the divine approval. First, so briefly upon this latter and lawful matrimony, so soon issue had. His proclamation regarding Anne's coronation likewise stresses her pregnancy as signaling divine approval, the security of the succession and descent of the crown, he says. Hall's Chronicle too reinforces the message, noting that wise men said God loved this marriage, considering that the new queen was so soon with child. And Anne herself comes right out and says that the marriage was divinely sanctioned. Just weeks after her coronation, she asserts to Capello, who we met a few pages back, that God had inspired His Majesty to marry her. But when a male heir did not materialize, the king began to doubt. It seems indisputable, as Greg Walker has outlined, that Anne's miscarriage of January 1536 was not necessarily fatal to her. That she was brought down instead by an unfortunately timed piece of slander combined with that miscarriage. On April 25th, 1536, less than a week before Anne's arrest, Henry was still negotiating for the emperor to recognize his marriage to Anne. The speed with which the king moved against her leaves the modern reader dizzy, and the hypothesis that he'd been motivated by sexual desire that had abruptly run its course seems particularly inadequate. More plausible is that the king's belief that Anne was divinely destined to continue the Tudor dynasty, badly shaken by the lack of a male heir, was destroyed by evidence in quotation marks, of Anne's multiple infidelities. The king had pitted Anne's moral authority against the disgust of much of Europe, and preposterous as the charges seem today, the king's credulity demonstrates how profound the belief in female vulnerability to desire was. Realizing that what he had taken for signs of divine approval were not signs of divine approval, the king suddenly understood that no son was forthcoming. It's difficult to let go of the image of Anne Boleyn as femme fatale and replace it with one more compatible with contemporary characterizations, like this one, for example, as a woman known for the, quote, the purity of her life, her constant virginity, her maidly and womanly pudicity, her soberness, chasteness, meekness, humility, and wisdom. The tragedy of her death feels all the more bleak. Nonetheless, for the sake of a more accurate vision of this woman and her life, I believe that we should imagine her in the company of the early and graceful French female reformers. Thank you very much.